Hello everyone. Today we will study nutrition in plant. This is the first chapter of class 7 science. In this video we shall discuss the key topics like nutrients, nutrition, various mode of nutrition and nutrient balance in the plants. Now what are nutrients? Nutrients are the components of food like the carbohydrates, the fats, proteins, vitamins and minerals. All these are called nutrients. Nutrients help living organism for building their bodies. That means for the growth of their bodies. How do the organisms grow? That is done by the nutrients which they take. And nutrients also help in the repair of the damaged parts of the body. And beside this, the nutrients also provide energy for various life processes like respiration, digestion, excretion, etc. Various life processes need energy for their functioning, and this energy is provided by the nutrients of the food. Now, what is nutrition? Nutrition is the mode of taking food by an organism. That means how do the organisms take their food and how do they utilize it for getting energy is called nutrition. The various modes of taking food by the organisms and its utilization by the body is called nutrition. There are two main mode of nutrition, and that is one is autotrophic mode of nutrition and another is heterotrophic mode of nutrition. Now what is autotrophic mode of nutrition? There are certain organisms which are green in color and they are able to synthesize their own food. That is done by the process called photosynthesis, and this is seen in green plants. So the green plants show autotrophic mode of nutrition because they can prepare their own food. Now second is heterotrophic mode of nutrition. In this, the organisms cannot prepare their own food. They have to depend on autotrophs, that means plants. Like the organisms cannot make their own food. They have to depend on plants like the animals. Animals are dependent on plants, so they show heterotrophic mode of nutrition. Now, we shall study autotrophic mode of nutrition in detail now. And that we will study under the process called photosynthesis. Photosynthesis is the process by which green plants make their own food. Green plants are able to prepare their food because they do have chlorophyll in their leaves. We can see this structure of the leaf here. This is the leaf, and leaf is having the tiny pores. We can see these tiny pores, and these are called stomata. The stomata are the tiny pores present in the leaves, and through these stomata the gaseous exchange takes place. We can see the stomata here and another stomata is here. The structure of stomata, if we discuss, it is having two guard cells. We can see the guard cells here. These are two kidney shaped cells we can see here, and these cells swell and the stomata get open. And when there is shortage of water, these guard cells shrink and the stomata get closed. These tiny pores are present in the leaves, and through these pores only the gaseous exchange takes place. How does the gaseous exchange takes place? That means the oxygen is released that comes out through the tiny pores, and the carbon dioxide is taken through these tiny pores. Now, how does photosynthesis takes place in the leaves? That we shall study in detail now. The sunlight is absorbed by the green pigment present in the leaves, and that green pigment is called chlorophyll. Chlorophyll absorbs sunlight, and then water is absorbed through the roots. Carbon dioxide is taken from the air through the stomata. And all these things together perform photosynthesis. And in photosynthesis, carbon dioxide and water combine in presence of chlorophyll and sunlight to form carbohydrates. This is all about photosynthesis. Telling one more time, photosynthesis is the process of preparing food by the green plants. Chlorophyll utilizes solar energy. And carbohydrates are formed, and later on these carbohydrates are converted into starch. We can see photosynthesis reaction here. This is carbon dioxide combining with water in presence of light energy, that means sunlight, and the chlorophyll present in the leaves. And all these things are making glucose, that is a carbohydrate, which is later on converted into carbohydrates, into starch. And oxygen is released in this process. We can see this from this diagram also. Water is absorbed by the roots, carbon dioxide taken through the stomata, and solar energy is absorbed by the chlorophyll. And then glucose is formed, we can see from here, and oxygen is released. This is the process of photosynthesis in green plants. Now, photosynthesis takes place in presence of sunlight. How we will prove this? We can prove this with the help of an activity. We'll take two potted plants of same kind, and then we will keep one plant in sunlight and another plant we will keep in dark room for about 72 hours or 2 to 3 days, we say. Then afterward we will pluck one leaf from each of the plant, and then we will perform the starch test. For performing the starch test, we will put the leaf in the spirit, and then we will boil this test tube containing spirit and the leaf. We'll boil it in, keep it in boiling water, because spirit should not be heated directly, right? We will heat it in a water bath, and we will continue heating till all the green color of the leaf comes out. And then we will take the leaf out, we'll wash it properly with water, and then we will perform starch test. How will we perform starch test? That means we will put some iodine solution on the bone, both the leaves, and then we will observe carefully both the leaves. We will see that the leaf which was kept in sunlight, that will turn blue-black in color, and the leaf which was kept in dark room will not turn blue-black, because the leaf of the plant which was in dark room has not performed any photosynthesis. No photosynthesis, no starch formation, so no blue-black color in the leaf. And on the other hand, the plant which was kept in sunlight, their photosynthesis has taken place and carbohydrates are formed, starch is formed, so it gives blue-black color. So this activity shows that sunlight is very necessary for photosynthesis. Now, how does plants obtain nitrogen for making proteins? Carbohydrates are formed during photosynthesis, but beside this, for making proteins, plants also need nitrogen. Then from where does this nitrogen come? Actually, the soil is providing nitrogen. We all know that nitrogen is the most abundant gas in the atmosphere. That is about 78% of nitrogen is present in the air. But this gaseous nitrogen cannot be utilized, cannot be absorbed by the plants. So there are some bacteria in the roots of leguminous plants. We can see the leguminous plant from here. This is a leguminous plant. Leguminous plants, the plants which belongs to the pulse family, legumes, like the beans, like the pea, gram, and all these, right? These are leguminous plants. These plants have some root nodules, and in these root nodules, we can see the root nodules from here. These are the root nodules. These root nodules are having some bacteria. These bacteria collect the gaseous nitrogen from the air and convert it into a usable form, that is water-soluble form, and that is nitrate. These nitrates are formed by these bacteria, and along with the water and other minerals, these are absorbed by the plants for making proteins. Proteins are made with the help of nitrogen, and nitrogen is absorbed in the form of nitrates from the soil along with water and other minerals. So this is how the plants absorb nitrogen in the form of nitrates from the soil. Now there are some other mode of nutrition we will study now under heterotrophic mode of nutrition. Heterotrophic mode of nutrition, there are three other mode of nutrition under heterotrophic mode of nutrition, that is parasitic mode of nutrition, saprotrophic mode of nutrition, and symbiotic mode of nutrition. And the first one we shall study here is parasitic mode of nutrition. Parasites are the plants which live on other plants. Parasites, plants, they do not have chlorophyll. They live on other plants and they take the food prepared by those plants. And the plant on which they live or the organism on which they live are called host plant. So here the special point about the parasites is because they derive their nutrition from the host plant, that's why they cause harm to the host plant. The host plant may die because all the nutrition is absorbed by the parasite. So parasites do not have chlorophyll. They are dependent on green plants or other organisms for their food, and these plants are called host plant. And example of this is Cuscuta, Amar Bale in Hindi, and another common name of this plant is yellow dodder. Yellow dodder, Amar Bale, and Cuscuta is the same thing. Now, insectivorous plants. What are insectivorous plants? These are the plants. These plants are actually green plants. So they do have chlorophyll. They can perform photosynthesis. But beside photosynthesis, they also eat insects. That's why we call them insect-eating plants or insectivorous plant. And one such example is pitcher plant. We can see from the diagram here, the leaf of the pitcher plant is modified in the form of a pitcher. We can see it from here. This is the shape of a pitcher. And the apex of the leaf is actually modified in the form of a lid, and which can open and close freely. When an insect enters the pitcher, the lid gets closed. And the insect inside the pitcher is entangled or trapped by the hair present inside the pitcher. And then the pitcher secretes some digestive juices. These digestive juices help in digestion of the insect. This is how the pitcher plants show dual mode of nutrition. That is autotrophic because it has green leaves also. It eats or feeds on insect because it has digestive juices inside the pitcher. So this is how it eats insects. Now, saprotrophic mode of nutrition. Saprotrophic mode of nutrition is seen in fungi, fungus. Saprotrophs are actually, these are the plants which do not have chlorophyll. So they are not green in color. That's why they cannot prepare their own food. They have to depend on other organisms for their own food. They actually feed on dead and decaying matter, and they derive their nutrition in solution form. Example of saprotrophs are bread mold, that is rhizopus, which grows on bread, and the mushroom. These are some examples of saprotrophs. The organisms which show saprotrophic mode of nutrition are called saprotrophs. How do the saprotrophs digest their food actually? They just grow on dead and decaying matter. And then they just convert the dead and decaying matter in a solution form, which is then absorbed by the saprotroph. Saprotroph, they produce some digestive juices where on the decaying matter. On the decaying matter, some digestive juices are secreted by the saprotrophs, and then it is converted into a solution form. And then this solution is absorbed by the saprotrophs. You can see the growth of fungi on the bread. The fungus which grows on bread is called bread mold, and another scientific name of this is rhizopus. We can do this activity even at home also. Take a piece of bread and slightly moisten it with water, sprinkle some water on it, and then leave it in a warm place for about 2 to 3 days. After 2 or 3 days, when you will observe it, you will see some fluffy patches on it. And these fluffy patches, when seen under the microscope, it appears like the cotton threads. These cotton threads are nothing but the fungi called rhizopus, or in common language, we call it bread mold. Bread mold, it is a saprotroph, cannot make its own food. It grows on bread, so bread is the food for this rhizopus. Now, symbiotic mode of nutrition is another example of heterotrophic mode of nutrition. In this mode of nutrition, actually, there are two partners. These two partners live together and share their food and shelter. This is one of a very good mode of nutrition. For example, let's take example of lichens. Like in lichens, one partner is algae and another is fungi. Algae and fungi live together, and the algae, because it is green, so it can do photosynthesis, so it makes food. And on the other hand, the fungus provide water and shelter to the algae. So both these, the algae and the fungi, live together, share their food, which is prepared by the algae, and share their shelter and water and minerals, which is absorbed by the fungi. So they just live together and both are getting the benefits here. Unlike the parasitic mode of nutrition, in which the one is getting the benefits and other, the host is being harmed. Right, but in case of symbiotic mode of nutrition, both the partners are getting the benefits and no one is being harmed. They love to stay together. Now, how the nutrients are replenished into the soil? Actually, when we just keep on growing plants on a particular piece of land, then the soil at that place becomes deficient in some nutrients. And for that purpose, the farmers have to apply or utilize some manure and fertilizers. But there is some technique by the nature to replenish the nutrients into the soil. Actually, what happens when the plant die? All the nutrients goes into the soil, because when the plant die and it is decomposed, the nutrients goes back into the soil. Beside this, the leguminous plants, root nodules of leguminous plants like the gram, pea and the beans, they do have some bacteria. The bacteria name is rhizobium. This rhizobium lives in the root nodules of leguminous plant. It has the ability of absorbing gaseous nitrogen from the air and then converting it into the water soluble form, and that water soluble form is nitrate. So this rhizobium bacteria takes nitrogen gas from the air and convert it into the water soluble form, that is nitrate. And these nitrates are formed in the soil along with the water and other minerals. These nitrates are absorbed by the roots. And because this rhizobium is living in the roots of the leguminous plants, this rhizobium is providing nitrates to the plant root. And the plant is providing food to this bacteria. So we can see here another example of symbiotic relationship, because the bacteria and the leguminous plant both are getting the benefit. The leguminous plant is getting the nitrates, and the bacteria, because it is a saprotroph and it is getting nutrition. Nutrition from the leguminous plant. So both are getting the benefits. So again, we can see this as an example of symbiotic relationship. So with this, we have completed the chapter. All the topics are cleared. Let's keep learning. Thank you so much.